My name is Debu, and I'll talk about my background in a second. So, a lot of this is luck. I grew up in Calcutta, in India. India at that time was a very different country when I was growing up. So, you can see my hair, I'm old enough to talk about that. I actually, even though I lived the first 22 years of my life in India, I started my career in Russia. So, I worked in Russia, I mean, already five. And I worked very briefly in India before that, then Russia, briefly Singapore, then the UK, back in India. Worked there for 2.5 years. I was married by then. Went to London to study. London, then went as a banker to Wall Street. Wall Street, Silicon Valley, Wall Street as a banker. London as a banker. Then my older daughter was born, and I knew at that point I needed to make some changes to my life. It wasn't going to work out. I probably have a very well-paid job, but a lot of other things were banished. So I made a strategic decision at that point to move into, at that time, the world of the internet. Now, in some senses, that's not exactly right, because I was a banker in the internet boom days, also in the bus. So I went through the boom and the bus. Luckily, boom first. So then, I always say luck, because it's a massive factor. You could think that you're the best at whatever you do. A lot of what we end up doing is driven by circumstance. It's the old saying that, you know, just live long enough, everything happens. That's true. It really is true. So I actually went to the world of online travel, joined a company called Saber. And those of you who know the world of travel, so travel is a very interesting business. It's basically the basic business on which e-commerce is built on. It's a horizontally scalable business. You can build one product and you can literally sell that same product across the world. Very few verticals go right across. Travel is one. I don't want to talk about the other one. There's one other business which scales, but may not be for public consumption yet. So I went into that, ended up buying for Saber a company called lastminute.com. We then took lastminute.com, merged it with Travelocity and Saber, and then sold it off to private equity. That was in 2007. A few months after that, the market shut down. You know, the whole, you know, there was a big crash that happened. I ended up joining Google. Again, very lucky that I was in the right place. And I ended up working on the M&A side and the investment side. 6+ years out there. And then 3 years back, I left Google. I knew at that point I was never going to work for anybody else in my life. That part of my life was done. And then last year, we set up Third Eye, which is a venture capital fund, and I'll talk about that in a second.
So that's the introduction. Now you know who we are, and we would like to know who you are. They will ask me backstage, who is in the audience? So let's find out. How many of you have a startup which you would like to take off and conquer the world? Raise your hand, please. Okay, startup founders. How many of you have raised funding with your startup? Okay, a couple of you. How many of you work for corporations? I see. Nice. Thank you for introducing yourselves.
I have one question. How many of you were born outside the UK?
Wow. That's amazing. Okay. So now that you know each other, let's give you a voice. So as you can see behind us is a screen and we're using Slido. Anybody who doesn't know how Slido works, please raise your hand. A few. So it's very simple. All you have to do is, if you have a question and you want to ask something interesting, all you have to do is just open your browser on your mobile. No need to download anything, just open your browser. Type in slido.com and that's it. And the hashtag is SG Europe, as you can see behind us. And you just ask away. I promise the top 5 questions will be answered and which ones you decide, because you can vote for questions you like. It's as simple as that. So, David, you mentioned a couple of deals and you became a banker at the beginning. So, how did you go from a banker into an investor?
It is a long journey. I don't know how many of you are ex-bankers out here, but it took me 5 years to get out of a pure banking mindset. So, what does that mean? I enjoy it. And I'm one of the few guys who say this, I enjoyed being a banker. But it came with its downsides. You know, it's a pretty harsh world. It's also a world, not just working hard, but you know, there are certain characteristics of it that you have to sign up to. And it took a long time. I'd never worked with engineers before that. It took me 5 years, having worked, to understand what it meant to work with engineers. Because it's very, very different to working with business people. And if you're going to build a tech business, one of the fundamental things you have to learn is how to work with engineers and product managers. That is, without that, you never make it successfully within a tech business. So, long stroke or a short answer to the long question is, it took me a fairly long time to get there. Even today, and we'll cover this at some point, the VC business model worries me because it's got a lot of challenges. Firstly, it's not a scalable business, right? VC funds don't scale, but VCs love investing in scalable businesses. It's an extremely hit-driven business. So think of making movies, multiply that by 10 in terms of risk factor, and that's the business that you're in, right? Two out of, you know, whatever, 30 companies will make it in your portfolio, but you have to fund 30 to get there. So second part of that is, it's a risky business. Third is, it's a business where often the timelines are very short, so you end up making investment decisions very quickly without a lot of data. That is very tricky. I found that part very tough because mentally, having been in a bank before, you take your time, you analyze properly, and then you make a considered decision. And then even half of the time, you're wrong. Here, you know that 80% of the time, you will be wrong. Now, that's a pretty daunting task. You've got to get into something where you know 80% of the time, you're probably going to be wrong. And 90% of the time, you're going to be wrong and possibly wrong.
So we'll be something on the VC side in a moment. Before that, I would like to know, you already mentioned the biggest M&A deal ever. Can you tell us something about it and why do you think it was such a fundamentally different deal from all the others?
It was actually the first deal I ever worked in as a banker. It is also considered the biggest failed M&A deal in history.
There you go.
Okay, it's the famous AOL Tag Warner merger. It is. So those of you go and check, it's the biggest ever M&A deal. It's also the biggest ever failed M&A deal in history. And you could write a book on why it was a big failure. But the reality is, it changed the industry. It's the first time that media and tech merged. And basically that deal is still considered the high point of the boom. For the right or the wrong reason, that's debatable. So, and I was a very junior guy, very, very junior. I ended up working on that in a very, very small way. But that was the first actually ever M&A deal that I ever worked in as a banker. But all I can say is I was seriously junior and I did a tiny, tiny part of it. But it's a great story.
Are you saying it's not your fault?
I wish I could say it was my fault because then I would have to be fairly well paid to have made those mistakes.
And then you went to Silicon Valley. Why did you decide to go there?
So when I was in business school, one of the things we ended up doing was we did a trip to Silicon Valley. And that is now we're talking about 1999, right? And I never been to Silicon Valley before that. And I don't know, I'm assuming most of you guys have, but those of you who haven't, try and do it. It is quite something. I did that in 99 and it had a huge impact. Right? Because I literally never seen anything like that in my life. We went to eBay. I remember, and eBay said they were seriously thinking of selling cars on the internet. And I remember all of us laughed. Who would ever buy a car on the internet? Doesn't make sense. Why would you buy something that expensive with the internet? Well, you know what the story is. And I remember all our meetings would happen, you know, right outside on the lawn, you know, sitting on the grass or whatever, and you'd have proper meetings sitting out there. All this today sounds, yeah, you know what, that's how life is. In those days, it definitely wasn't. It absolutely wasn't. I was just sitting in my beautiful office on Sand Hill, which is very bankerish. Those of you who've been to Sand Hill probably know what I'm saying. And then I would go and meet all these tabs, and I'd be sitting on the floor, on the grass, wherever. Right? It's just a completely different culture. And I'm so glad to see that most of it's done. I dressed up for you guys, I wore a suit today, or I wore a jacket. But the day I left banking, I've never worn a tie since then. I promised myself never wear a tie. I almost always wear a t-shirt if I can, for various practical reasons also. I stopped wearing shirts. I wear it once in a while. Sometimes you can't get into some places without a shirt. but I literally do it just to get into a place. But it had a fundamental change, so.
Yeah, and let's zoom in on the interesting part, which I would like to know all about, which is the Google part of your career. How did you get into Google?
So Google's hiring policies today are very different to what it was in 2007. So in those days, generally you went through about 20 interviews, and then your file, after they made an offer, would go to what was called a European Hiring Committee. From the European Hiring Committee, it would go to what was called a Global Hiring Committee. From the Global Hiring Committee, it would go to Larry Page, and then Larry would make a decision. Right? It was literally as cumbersome as that. Today it's totally streamlined. 5 interviews, and they give you a yes, no answer today at Google. Right? In those days, it wasn't like that. So when I first got a call, and I was planning to leave Sabre at that point, I had already done the successful sale. I knew I wasn't going to stay back for another 10 years to have the whole investment group, you know, sort of run through again. So Google approached, and I said no. And I said no for only one practical reason. One is, I wasn't going to subject myself to a six-month recruitment process. You know, I was old enough, I knew what I was worth, and I was not going to subject myself to it. So they said, and it was quite shocking to them, because very early in those days, when we were saying no to Google, today many more people say no. In those days, it wasn't that common. So they then came back and said, what if we promise that everything's going to happen in 2 weeks? So I said, how do I know you're going to do it in 2 weeks? And they said, yeah, just trust us. There's a reason why. So I told them two interesting things. I told them I have a Hotmail account. You know, and it sounds trite what I'm saying now, but in those days at Google, when you say you have Hotmail, that was, I can't describe how it felt. I could see in their face, you know, this guy says he's got Hotmail, because I gave them a Hotmail to write to. I actually had a Gmail also, but I didn't work with them. I didn't want to make it that easy. And you could see that whole thing, proceeding the whole thing. But they kept their word. The whole interview process in London and in Monterey was done in 10 days. I remember my last interview day was the day that Obama was actually campaigning at that point. And he was very close to a lot of the people at Google. So he had come over that day at Google in Mountain View to basically press the flesh. And I remember seeing him very briefly, you know, just saw him walking off. And it was done. So that's how I ended up joining Google. And I must say, it was a pretty amazing experience. It's one of the best companies I worked for. And the thing that I always remember about Google, and I always say this, it's the only company I've worked for where people help each other without expecting anything in return. It's the only company I've ever worked in. And that's quite something for a large company. And I always say this, when you're building your own startups, make sure that people help each other. There's nothing better, because that really scales. Nothing else scales like people helping each other.
It's a good question. So I'm at Google, and how did you went straight into the M&A department? And there were eight of you. And 8 people did 55 deals a year. That's crazy.
Yeah, so there were 9 of us to start. There were 10 of us to start with, and then through attrition, it came down to 8 at one point. So one of the guys who left our team is an interesting guy. He is Kevin Sistrom. Kevin was the founder of Instagram. Kevin was in our team. And so we had 2 people who left over time, and our team came down to 8. And if you go back and check the SEC filings that Google had in those days, on an average, we did between 50 and 55 acquisitions a year, plus investments. So keep in mind, Google invests through 3 arms. Today, 3 arms. In those days, 2 arms. Google itself, so Google.com and Google Ventures in those days. And now you've got one more called G Capital to do more growth, private equity deals. So that's the scale at which we were working. One other interesting thing, we almost rarely hire bankers. Okay, almost rarely. So of all the deals that we did in 5 years, I think we hired bankers twice. But what is more interesting, and this is unfortunately in a public forum when I'm being filled with very difficult talk, is more the deals we never ended up doing that are actually more interesting. Because I think that's
interesting. Let's talk about that.
It's impossible giving names because, you know, I'll get sued. Okay. I'll make it hypothetically, you know what I'm saying. One company that almost certainly 100% of you used it, we seriously looked at them. And they put a master strategy on us. They got another investor to come in and write them a tiny check and a massive valuation. If you're ever blocking a potential acquirer, there's no better strategy. They only took a tiny amount of money, but at a valuation that even for us in those days was tough to match. Now, I'm telling you that I'm 100% certain 100% of you are using that particular product. But man, it's tough for me to talk about it. And I've got a whole bunch of stories like this.
Okay, well, from all the deals you did at Google, which is the one which you enjoy the most working on?
It's probably a deal I think most of you may not know. It's a very interesting company that came out of MIT. It's called Eye Debu. It's travel. It's a travel startup. But what it basically did was it took all the flight data all over the world, put that together, mashed it, and then basically would make suggestions as to what was the best flight routing to take. It's basically what Google ended up buying to set up Google Travel. And the reason why I say it's a really interesting acquisition is, as a deal guy, what you really look for, the ones you remember always are not the biggest deals. It's almost always the toughest or the most interesting ones. So the reason why this was interesting was there were 7 other counter offers. Okay, most of them were priced higher than our bid. And it was fascinating that we were able to close a deal that was almost at the lowest price of 8 bids. Any of you who are deal guys will know how tough that is to manage that. Number one. Number two, we got sued right after the deal. And we went through a full antitrust process. Now again, I don't know if any of you are antitrust lawyers out here. I've been through 3 or 4 antitrust deals. Every time you go through an antitrust, you age. You age visibly. It's not for the pain, huh?
Okay. So that's quite some interesting stuff you're talking about. What I'd like to know is, when you work on a good M&A deal, how do you tell all the great companies from those medium companies? What are some shortcuts which you, or some warning signs which you see in the company that make you raise your eyebrow?
So, I'll give you how I used to be in my 20s and 30s and how I am today. It's like the older. As a deal guy, when I was younger, I was, you know, I had too much abuse, right? Now you just get caught up in yourself. And the big mistake that as a deal guy, someone like me, I always make, because I always thought it was a company that you're buying, right? You thought you were buying a technology, you thought you were buying a product, you thought you were buying market share. In reality, what you're really buying is a set of people who are highly ambitious. That's all. Everything else is fungible within certain parameters. And for me, the big learning of the M&A process always was, how do you retain people? So I have a metric, which is, you must have the top 10 people stay for at least 3 years post-acquisition. This is really important. Your deal metrics dramatically go up. That means your deal becomes more successful as you can retain the key people. Almost always, to me, that's a predictor of success. There are certain exceptions, like if you are P&G and you're buying another listed company, probably the management team is important, but not as important in relative terms. You're really looking to buy another product, put it into your marketing machine, and then throw it out, spit it out, right? The company doesn't work that way, because your assets walk in and out of that turns out every day. So you're in effect investing in the people, so you need to know what your retention strategy is. That's how I've always worked. So I don't do, for the last 15 years, I've never done earn-outs. Those of you who've been through an M&A deal, you know what earn-out is. It's a way when a buyer locks you in as the selling company, saying you have to hit certain financial targets. And if you hit those, it will give you more money. I've never done that purely because it sets the wrong incentive structure. Right? There's what is called misalignment of interest as a result.
I understand. We have a question here from Adrian, and Adrian wants to know, how can we simplify and shorten the due diligence process in funding and M&As? What is your take on that?
Sorry, who's Adrian? Is your question relating to funding or M&A or both? Is it completely different?
We're a 15-year-old company. We're looking to accelerate an exit. I think confronted with the fact that there are vulnerable lawyers involved in this, there are actually two lessons.
Yeah, that is sad. So I always, give three tips if you're selling, especially if you're selling a tech company. Firstly, never share your cap table with the potential buyer until you're pretty late in the process. The reason is, it's pretty easy to look at a cap table and back calculate the expected value. The expected value, not to you, but to your investors. So something like me, what I'll do is if I'm doing a cap table, I just calculate backwards, put a multiple of 3 to 6, depending on how high growth you are. And I know that at that point, your investor starts getting very happy. You may not be happy, right? So it's complete, so number one. Number two is, if you're going to let due diligence happen, do it under controlled circumstances so you can control the due diligence itself. Right? How long it is going to be, what the process is going to be, what are you going to show. And out here, if you can have more than one bidder, always helps. Nothing gets you a higher price than more than one bidder. It's just how the market works. So cutting down the process, manage it yourself. Manage it. When I say yourself, I mean you as an individual with your lawyer and with your advisor.
Would you advise to take any external advisors on board?
If you are early stage and you've got very little business experience, yes, I would say do it. If the buyer on the other side is experienced, I think the first thing he or she will do, they will try and get you advice off. Right? That's what I always did. I tried my best to make sure that I was working directly with entrepreneurs. Because you get a much better relationship overall. But I also know putting on a hack today, sometimes using an advisor makes sense.
Yeah. I have a friend of mine who just sold his company, half of the company, to LG 4 months ago. And I agree with not sharing the cap table because, for example, he managed in during the process of 15 months, increase the value of 5 times, which is quite amazing considering he just didn't want to tell the price, and they had some steps how they made companies bidding against each other. So I agree on that.
So one thing I'd say, since a lot of you are young companies, if you see a big company coming and making what is called a bid for you, before you waste a lot of time doing due diligence, just make sure that they're serious. Just make sure of that.
How do you screen that?
So the two ways is, firstly, don't show a lot of your documents, okay? Do very limited due diligence and tell them to do what is called a put up or shut up, which is you put a price with a timeline. Okay, nothing concentrates the mind like a number. Literally nothing concentrates. 90% of M&A approaches that happen are bogus. That means the bidder has no interest in you and actually want to just find out more about you using the acquisition process. So do what is called a put up or shut up. Give a price with a time frame and then manage that. You know very, very quickly who's got it. Number two, look at the bidder's acquisition history. If you're dealing with a very sophisticated buyer, you can be sure that they have a process which they've done rinse and repeat many, many times. There are very few of such buyers. So whenever you're going with a buyer who has no acquisition history, it's always going to be longer. But be prepared for that. But also be wary that you have to have a plan B for yourself. I always say just keep in mind, since a lot of you are young companies, you want to keep that in mind.
It's a useful advice. How do you see which companies are just trying to look at the company and just do it for espionage purposes and so on? Are there any signs?
So, I don't know if any of you guys have WhatsApp in Mali, but there are some really good scenes out there. One of the best ways of making out a company is scamming you. Is suddenly, very early on in the company, they send you a very massive due diligence list. And then the first meeting is all about your engineering and backend. And you suddenly have from the other side 10 people joining the meeting. They're asking you extremely detailed architectural questions. It's quite okay to have a level of detail, but when you're making out that it's going right down into your IP, that typically is something you want to be careful of. Now, if it's a sophisticated buyer, if you're dealing with one of the big four, that's fine, because you know, they have a process that they will go down. But if they don't have a history of doing lots of acquisitions. The second go there, be careful. That's typically one of the first signals.
Very useful. We've got a question here, and the question is, can you walk us through some of the key considerations for Google M&A when you're looking at buying a company?
Who asked this question? Great question. So, the biggest bias today is 7 or 8 companies today controlled by 80% of the M&A market today. It's pretty sad because it pretty much means there's a huge concentration of power in the hands of a few. So a Google, when they're buying a company, and actually I could answer this for Facebook or for Amazon. So there are four things they're looking for. And I'm going to put it in a very structured way. Number one is team. Next is team plus technology. Third is team plus technology plus product. And the fourth, which is very rare, is team plus technology plus product plus market share. Okay, market share is typically where it's relatively less. And market share, don't think of market share in the classic old-fashioned way of, you know, somebody's buying revenues. When Facebook bought WhatsApp, there's an element of market share, right? Because WhatsApp was massive in India. Okay, and it made a lot of sense. So this is the four criteria that they're looking for. Now, what does team mean? Team means what I call in my word, a saleable team, a team that is smart, talented, highly ambitious, and with the right attitude. Right? That's generally team. Technology, when I'm saying team plus technology, means technology which, you know, has been built but hasn't scaled. That's when you're doing team plus technology. The next stage is team plus technology plus product. That means the technology has scaled, the product has been built, but the product hasn't scaled or productized. Okay, that's typically fairly common, right? Then you have, which is the holy grail, you've got somebody who's got a great team, terrific technology, which you can either port in or you can build a new business out of it, and a product set, which is either fits right into your product set or can be a completely new business. So when Facebook bought Instagram, it was a completely new business for them, right? That's what Instagram did for Facebook. That's a great way of thinking. Most technology acquisitions for Google tend to be acquihires or technology plus team acquisitions. So it's smaller than the scale. So 55 that I'm talking of, I would say 70% of the acquisition would be plus technology.
When you look at a company and you have all these filters, you look at this company through, are there any things which make you pay attention to, this looks too beautiful, this is suspicious?
You think from an M&A process, I'm
basically. When you look at a company and it just looks too good to be true.
I mean, generally if it's too good to be true, it generally is. I mean, it's a old adage. But the signals typically are when you see the founders again in the exit. Now this takes some experience to figure out, right? Because the value world of M&A is completely different to the way it works here. Here it's much more what I call normal, right? You know, there's a process, people can go and sell or they raise money. But the value is it's like a real hothouse, right? Everything is done at supersonic speed and you have very little time. And if you're not careful, you can end up buying or investing in a company for completely the wrong reason, because somebody just speaks beautifully, shows beautiful slides, and is able to do great product demos. And I've made my own share of those, right? You know, you cannot go through this business without having made many, many failures, right? So when John Doerr at Kleiner Perkins says, building a VC business or building a venture capitalist is like investing in a fighter pilot, he's absolutely right. It's 7 years, $20 million. That's what you're going to burn. Every successful VC. This is no other way. You've got to waste a lot of money in the whole process. Right? And that's why it's a weird business model, because you're going to burn through a lot of money making mistakes. But it's worth it. But it's like investing in a fighter pilot. Literally, that's what the US and the UK spent on every fighter pilot. 7 years, $20 million. That's exactly what you do in a VC fund.
Very good answer. When you work on an M&A deal and you get you catch the founder not telling the truth. Let's talk about the integrity for a moment. Is this a deal breaker for you, or there are some limits which you can tolerate some behavior in the process?
What kind of behavior?
For example, they make the numbers look better than they actually are, or they overestimate, or they make the company sound much, much better than they actually are. They say they sign a deal which, while they only are in the process of negotiating. Are these signs something which would make you not do the deal?
So one of the things being a deal type, both on the M&A and the investing side, is I'm going to be careful how I say this. You see generally two sides of human nature. You see the best and the worst. The middle is more difficult to see because everybody's putting on a performance. I can't even think of it. We all do that. When you're going and raising money, you're doing a performance. It's a one or two act play, sometimes a three act play. Maybe it's a play. It's a performance that you're doing. Same in an M&A process, there's a performance happening. And the key over time with experience is understanding the performance and the reality behind it. Integrity is a difficult word. I would love to give you a very nice, long answer to this. The reality is, we live in a world now where everything is exaggerated. So obviously, you expect a founder to exaggerate. That's, in fact, in America, one of the things I remember being told is, if you can't sell yourself, why should somebody invest in you? I've always remembered that. It's not a phrase you typically expect to hear in the UK, right? That kind of a phrase. But I also understand what it really means, that the art of selling yourself means selling your vision, selling your passions, selling everything else. So what would worry me? The things that typically worry me are, and I've done this in my own way, I ask the same question in different ways. And I look for patterns in the answers, generally. It's generally a very good way of figuring out when somebody's being consistent. The thing is, when somebody lies, it's very difficult to consistently lie. Because you have to remember every time that you're making things up, you have to remember that consistency. That's what I generally tend to do. And I'm looking for these pattern breaks generally. It's pretty easy, because I'll ask the same question in different ways, it doesn't sound like the same question. I'll figure it out. As an investor, that's what you're also trying to do constantly. You're trying to understand, you know, there is an element of selling, and you know there's an element of hype behind the numbers, the product, and everything else. But you're really trying to get a sense of, it's the steady state. What would happen given the variables being money, quality of team, the engineering and the time? Can the product go, whether it's today, to another place? As an investor, that's what you're generally looking at a series A, which is what we do.
So integrity is a integral part of the play. Yes. Now, let's move on to your VC part. So you've been at Google for 6 years, and then you went the next day to VC World. Why?
So, I literally left Google Monday. Next morning, I joined the fund. I joined them as the EIR. It's called Octopus. Extremely good fund.
How many of you don't know what Octopus is? Didn't hear about Octopus?
So they're one of the biggest funds now in London, by a mile.
They're about 6 billion under management?
Yeah, something more. On the VC side, they probably have now about 800-900, something like that right now. On the AI side, they really are the pioneers on the venture capital side, because they've had more exits on the AI side than anybody else has. Right? And they're focused on the best buyers in the world, Amazon, Google, you know, people, Microsoft, people like them. They're sole companies. That's typically one of the hardest things to do. So I ended up joining them as an EIR. The reason was very simple. I wasn't completely sold on the VC business for the reasons I said. But there's no better way of learning it than from the inside, right? And that's what I wanted to learn. I wanted to learn not the investing side, but how you manage, you know, money. That part of it. The portfolio side. That's what I really wanted to understand. It was fascinating going down that particular process, because it's completely different to the M&A side. And then last year, we set up our vehicle. And you know, it's really been fun. There's no better, and those of you who are entrepreneurs yourself, you know, there's no better thing than to run your own.
Okay. So Octopus, just to conclude this part, you were mentoring founders, you were helping them what were you responsible for at Octopus?
Oh, Octopus, yes.
So, the entrepreneur in residence title, job title, is a very fancy one. You can literally make it whatever you want it to be. So, what I ended up doing was I spent a lot of time with the portfolio companies, spent some time also on the investment side. And the third thing was, you know, working with the teams also on some of the basics on the fundraising side. So that's what I ended up doing. That was great fun. And the fourth thing that I ended up doing with them, which was really a good learning for me, was understanding the portfolio side, the pure portfolio management side, which is finance, nothing but finance, right? Ultimately, the investment business is very simple. You invest, and you make money, and then hopefully you return your fund round. So one big difference between the venture capital business and the private equity business is it's not an IRR business. It's a business based on absolute return. It's called number of times you return the fund on a cash basis. So if you have $100 million fund and you return $200 million back, that's called a 2x fund. Right? It's very simple. Whereas on the private equity side, everything is paid back down to an IRR. Obviously, you can do the absolute return back to an IRR also if you would like.
So you had some concerns about the VC industry, and then the next thing you do, you start a VC fund.
Yeah, I mean, I spent 2.5 years learning it. Right, that's enough time. And I sort of sense at the end of it what I wanted to do. So the way we've set this up is, it's a mixture of the private equity and the VC business. We call it Third Eye. So I'm from India, where I'm from in India, the Third Eye is the eye that sees everything, supposedly. So I thought I would really pick that.
By using those cool tools to see everything?
So we ended up doing that. It's a classic, what is called a Series A investment vehicle. We tend to do Series A checks between $2 and $10 million per check size. We are called a heavy investor, so that means we spend a lot of time with the teams. And as a result, you know, we tend to do no more than out of this current vehicle, no more than 3 to 5 deals a year. In fact, at 5, we get capped out there. So the plan is to do fairly, you know, low number of investments on an annual basis, but put a lot of time and effort and write fairly large checks. And if necessary, we write the full check. So the first deal that we did in the cybersecurity space, we did the full round. We didn't take any other investment. Now, those of you who are investors will know that's a very risky strategy. Right? Very few investors like doing that. So we did that, and we did two very interesting things as we did that. In the first deal that we did, we took out the preference stack. So again, those of you finance people who know what I'm saying. We took out all the preference equity and made everything into ordinary shares. Now, very few of any investor does that, because that means you are lowering your class of shares. So we did that. The other interesting thing we faced, which is a big moral dilemma for us, we closed the deal a few days after Brexit, and we took a real bath, right? Because we were investing in euros, and we were using pounds. So as the pound fell, we took a massive bath, right? Because it was an actual loss, it's a crystallized loss. We need to figure out a way of switching that. So we took a real bath on that. And we asked ourselves, because most of the VCs post-Brexit stopped investing. Right, they literally stopped investing or took a pause. And we were new, and we were sort of thinking, what do we do now? And we said to ourselves, you know, let's do what the right thing is, which is go and write the check that we committed, because otherwise, you know, why would anybody else ever trust us? Right? It was like very scary, because we took an immediate loss, a cash loss, because we were selling sterling, buying euros, and then investing. But it was so worth it, because with our first startup, we have such a good relationship. As an investor, what you're always looking for is a really high-quality relationship with your startup team. Because if you can work together, it makes all the difference.
That's true. So, it's Third Eye, you're the managing partner. How big is the team so far?
So, right now, the way we've got it set up is there are two of us. And then, I'm actually in the process of hiring. So, Mariana and I were talking about it. So, I've been going in and out. Yeah, so we're looking for a high-quality product manager. Okay, somebody who's worked
on either the B2B or the B2C side, but it's definitely launched, and this is the important part, has launched at least 3 or 4 products. In my world, it's called shipping. You ship 3 or 4 products. It's really important. So we're looking for somebody in that space. We're also looking for a few advisors, primarily on the engineering side. So think of something like what's called a classic BP engineering role, somebody who is gets the engine room running. They're looking for advice on that space.
So if Debu stays behind for a few minutes longer, feel free, if you know somebody, you would like to recommend somebody, feel free to come and tell Debu about it. Debu, how big is your fund?
So we have what is called an SPV structure, so special purpose vehicle. So we have a pot of money that sits inside a company. And then our ability is to write anything between 3 to 5 checks up to 10 million a year. So we want to do between 30 to 50 million of check writing every year. That's the plan. So that's how we structured it, and we work with some external investors as we do that. So it's not your traditional fund structure, but to a startup, it makes, you know, it's exactly mirrors a fund. So you would see if you're investing, if you're taking our money, from your side, it makes no difference. You're seeing the same as a fund would. And then we write the check immediately. And then we then go back to a couple of our investors and then do what is called syndicated back into them, a particular fund. But from your side, as a startup, it's exactly a fund.
Yeah. There's something very interesting about you and unusual. So Third Eye has the scope of Europe and Israel. And you also are involved in Gaza. You're also involved in Palestine. You're doing something in Iran, Syria. Tell us something about that. That's very interesting.
So this is interesting. So many years back when I was in Google, when I first joined, I'm not talking 10 years back, you know, one of my colleagues dragged me to Palestine. Okay, I'd never been there before, and I don't know if any of you have been, but it's a fascinating place. So I ended up going there, and it had a huge impact on my life. It really, you know, I'd never seen a conflict zone before, like, properly. And I remember working out there, and I went through some pretty interesting experiences on that first trip. We took a car journey from Omaha in Palestine all the way to Jordan. But it sounds, if you look at the map, it's nothing. On the map, you know, it's a short distance. But what really happened to us was you go through 7 checkpoints. It's not further, it's quite an experience. I'm Indian with a British passport in those days. There was a West Indian guy with a Jordanian passport. There was an Egyptian guy with the Egyptian passport. There was an English lady with an English passport but with an American accent. And there was one other person. We got strip searched everywhere, literally. But it was such an amazing experience, and since then I've gone back to Israel every year 2 or 3 times. And I end up actually out there working on all sides. We invest in Israel. I also ended up buying some companies for Google in Israel. I end up working in Gaza where, you know, through a separate vehicle that I sit on the board of, we've set up a technology accelerator called Gaza Psychics in Gaza. So if any of you are looking for interesting charitable causes, that's definitely one I'd recommend. And then I also go into Palestine, to Ramallah, and do some work out there. But the interesting thing for me is I always say I have the huge advantage of being a foreigner, right? I can be whatever you want me to be at that particular point. I can move my accent up, down, left, right, center. I can, I can't change my skin color, but I can do more or less every other thing. It's hugely advantageous as I did that. I go and do some work in the Mecca Valley, which is on the, if you want to have a look, that's the Syrian border. It's interesting, because that area is not controlled anymore by the Lebanese army. It's controlled by somebody else, right? But it's fascinating when you go and do that, because you learn, and I find that it makes me a better investor and a better deal person, having lived and gone and worked out there, because I have a completely different perspective now as I go and work out there. Other thing I find what is not for me is it's built a resilience in me that I probably didn't have before. You watch people who are doing something which is really tough. Okay.
and they do it smilingly. And for them, life where they get bombed in the morning and then go and play in the afternoon, it's just different. It's something that you and I can't even conceive, right? That's life. That's how a lot of people live. And watching them, I find it incredibly, you know, it's uplifting for me. It should have been sad, but I actually find it uplifting as I do this, because it's fine. I learn so much, the whole process.
That's amazing. Thank you for doing it. We have a question here on Slido from Tim, and Tim wants to know, you mentioned luck and being lucky at various stages through journey. When were you last unlucky and how did you bounce back?
Good question. See, I tend to never look at the negatives. I almost always look. I very rarely look back in anything that I do. That's how my psyche is. And I only tend to look at everything positively. So you're asking a question that is tough. I actually find this. Luck. I thought one thing that definitely struck me is when I first came and started working in the UK. And I don't know how many of you, and I know there's a lot of you who are not born in this country. The visa regime was really tough. I kept thinking to myself, you know, that is so unfair. You come to your country, you come with all your dreams, and then you find that you have to work through this whole bureaucratic nightmare of getting a visa. And I found that really, really tough. It's probably the only time in my life I've probably said to myself, my God, this is so unfair. But it also sort of pushed at me my other side, which is the highly competitive side of it. I figured out how it worked, figured out how the model worked, and I'm one of the first guys when in the UK for a brief while there was something called an HSMP. Highly skilled migrant program. I remember going to my bank and saying, I want to turn in my work permit and go for an HSMP, which in those days was unheard of because it basically meant you were giving up the security of your company's visa. But I sort of sensed that it was way better, you know, hanging on to your own destiny, or at least, you know, managing your own destiny. So that is probably the only time when I felt luck, feeding me.
I see. Let's talk about getting lucky in terms of getting investment from you. What kind of people or what makes somebody stand out in your mind so that you invest? And what are the common mistakes people do when they pitch to you which makes you not ending up investing in a company?
Yeah, so I'm slightly different as a person when I look at this. I'm one of the few people who do cold calls. So most investors will not look at you unless you come through what is called a trusted source. I don't care. I'm happy to talk to anybody because it's obviously helpful if it comes to a trusted source, but I'm happy to talk to anybody. What are we looking for? We're looking, because we are Series A, so we tend to be the first proper investment, institutional investment that comes in. We are looking, so I'm going to break it up between B2B and B2C. On the B2B side, we're looking for some revenues and or a product which is going to change technological difference. So the tech behind it is what we're looking for. On the B2C side, we're not necessarily looking for any revenues, but we're looking for metrics. So we have our own list of 6 or 7 metrics that we tend to look at on the B2C side. I personally come on the B2C side, so I've got a fair bit of experience on that side. And there are 6 or 7 metrics that we tend to look for, and then really speaking, what we are investing in is the quality of the team. So that's the base things that we are always looking for. In terms of, let me put a more positive spin, what am I really looking for? I'm looking for the collective ambition of a team. That's what I really care about. And I keep repeating myself on this. Ambition is the one thing that's very difficult to change. You have it to the extent that you have it. It's very difficult to retrofit, it's very difficult to bolster, very difficult to increase. Right, it's one of the things you're built with, and over time there are small changes that happen. So your ambition goes up or down, but it's not significantly up or down. So what I'm really looking for is the collective ambition of the team, not one individual, not only the founder. That's fundamentally what I'm looking for. One, and number two, and I always visualize when I'm sitting with the team, a room at some point later on when a deal is getting done, say an IPO or a sale. Great sale of the startup. And I've been in that room many, many times over many, many years in different countries and different continents.
I visualize that company. And I try and sense, are these 3, 4, 5, or 6 individuals, would they be able to hold their own in that role? And because I've done it so many times, I have my own role play. So, for a few of you who look at cricket, you know, cricket in batsmen do what is called visualization. They set up the pitch, they imagine the bowler coming in, actually visualize it. You can do that in a real way.
Yeah. We have about 5 minutes left. Before we go and answer some of your questions in person and from Slido, I would like to spend a minute talking about your board member career. I don't know how do you do it, but you are on the board of London Business School. You are on the board of companies. You are the chairman of the advisory board of Vion, which is formerly Bipocom, which has more than 10 billion revenues and 235 million customers. Can you tell us something about how you manage your time in terms of being on these boards and which boards are most important in your mind?
So all the boards are important, and this is not a politically correct answer. It actually is, because I wouldn't do it if it wasn't important to me. So I sit around here, I sit on Cambridge Enterprise, which is the IP arm and the business arm of Cambridge University. I sit on that board, I sit on the business school, the curriculum committee, and then a few other places, including Vion, which is a large telco, that's the chairman of the advisory board. I'm pretty good at time nowadays. I used to be really poor at it when I was young. And if I were to go back to my younger self and teach myself something, it's just how to manage time. Today I'm much better at managing time. So I'm pretty good at that. I'm fairly regimented in the way I manage my time. And I have a certain way that I manage it every day. I also tend to, on my boards, reply very fast. I tend to do almost everything on WhatsApp as much as I can. Not email, I find that much more useful for me. And I'm on most of the apps, so I'm on Telegram, I'm on WeChat, I'm on WhatsApp, I'm on Facebook Messenger. The reason I do it is because I just find that much faster to work for myself, at least my style. Because I don't want to write a long message, I hate writing a long message, so I just very quickly get to the point and then move it along. The only chat messaging I don't use much, frankly, is LinkedIn. I just don't find it very user-friendly, so I don't tend to use it much. Not with anything else. And I've just become decent at managing my time. And one of the things I do every year is, at the end of the year, I actually look at everything on my portfolio, and I remove one. And then next year, I go and pick one or two new things. It's the only way I can regenerate myself.
Wow, okay. Now, let's do some quick questions, quick answers. There's a question from Anonymous here, and he or she wants to know, what are your thoughts on crypto or ICO disrupting the VC industry?
So the VC industry is getting disrupted, and it's going to get disrupted even more. The crypto part is actually one small part of it. Angel is, and the models definitely are one angle to it. The early stage of the VC cycle, so the whole seed and pre-seed and everything else, the angel side, is pretty much getting disrupted now. The later stage is not so much yet, but it's a question of time before they do. The ICO part is very, very interesting because, in effect, you are creating the parameters for yourself to write, create a new currency. I'd be very interested to see the regulatory response, and I'm not talking about China. Because this is a direct threat to every government, right? In effect, it's saying government regulation on regarding money no longer matters. And I really would like to see what the regulators do, because this is one where I see a stronger regulatory response coming in. It'll take time, but it will be coming. And that, to a large extent, will define the industry. The crypto part, especially the blockchain part, is here to stay, but more importantly, it's going to be a key driver going forward. It's going to have a huge impact on the way business and banking is done, especially on counterparties where there's a lot of trust between the counterparties. So that is not the issue. The whole ICO structure, I think the regulatory sort of impact of it is still not yet seen.
I have to admit that we are in the middle of raising a 200 fund with our partners for Central Europe, and we are seriously considering doing an ICO, but I agree the regulation is something which is a big question mark, and also the timing, because there's probably going to be a correction of the market.
Yeah, I mean, The regulatory part is really the big thing, because those of you who've seen the way ICOs are raised, in effect, it means you create your own rules, right, in a practical way. And then you are able to then raise money out of those structures. That is actually really innovative. But it basically means government regulations to a very large extent, you know, really dramatic. And that, I can't see governments just waiting and saying, you know what, that's mine. I just can't see governments doing that.
Yeah. Well, one question was Lilo, and the question is, what effect do you think crowdfunding will have or has on traditional VC?
On the early stages, so that's what I'm talking about, the angel stage or the pre-seed stage or even the friends and family stage. The family's too early. The next stage after that, the angel and the pre-seed, yes, quite a bit.
Yes. Let's now take two or three questions from yourselves directly. Raise your hand. Okay, there's one question here.
Yeah, Debu, thanks for the lot. Yeah, I'm also from Texas in Qatar. Question, because London is quite not mature compared to Silicon Valley. Of course, in Silicon Valley, they have Berkeley, they have Stanford as the main centers in Tech City in back then. I don't find that there's much collaboration or communication or whatever between our universities and Tech City. So, for example, you mentioned the school in Cambridge, well, the tech is going on. What can they do more to improve that communication and collaboration?
Because, so if I were to compare it to when I first came here, there was hardly any collaboration. Now it is not entirely the case. Increasingly, in fact, I was at Cambridge 2 weeks back in the Valley, and we spent a lot of time with other institutions just talking to them about collaborating. I think where industry or education institutions haven't quite done like the way American institutions have, they haven't quite engaged with say corporations as much as in the US that they've done. But even that's changing now here. So I'm actually much more optimistic than you are in that particular part, because I can see some of it happening. One of the very interesting things that I see about institutions here is that American institutions have very strong connections with their alumni. UK institutions don't, and that is something I've never understood. Right? It's, they are your real base, but go to the university and see what kind of connection you have with them. There's hardly any. That actually is the fatal gap today in the UK education system, just the lack of connection that universities have with their alumni. The US is incredible the way they're connected.
Thank you very much for your very, very interesting, very insightful. Ariana, my name. You seem to have made a huge progress in time management. You mentioned it a couple of times. Could you give any insight about what specifically your learnings were and what you recommend? Thank you.
I think the reason I'm laughing, it used to be, and it still is, according to my wife, one of my weakest things, managing time. As you get older, you become better at things. You value time. I now know. And it sounds weird to say it like this. I have a sense of time and the fact that it's finite. It's no longer infinite to me. And I think of that all the time. So the way I do it is I carve, so before I go into a meeting, I think of one or two things that I want out of that meeting. And I think of it in a very structured way. Because I do lots and lots of meetings every day. So I don't go to a meeting without having in my mind what I want out of the meeting. Generally, I will try and stop the meeting exactly at that point when it finishes. Right? I would not like to go and extend it if I can. The few times when I do it is because it's really worth it at that point. One. I also try and have different days of the week for different things. I try and carve out a fair bit of time to read. I feel I don't read enough. And always all this, I just feel I don't read enough. So when I hear about people that wouldn't bother spending 3 days of the week reading, I feel very nervous because I know I'm not reading enough. So I'm always trying to carve out more time to read. And the fourth is having sorted out your priorities to a certain extent. You know, once you have kids and all, I find it became very easy for me. You know, there's a certain amount of time that I had to carve alongside. And I found that really worked. It really, so I also have between family and work, but then work back then again. So I break it down or slice and dice it on a daily basis, and then I always try and get something out of my meetings. And actually write down every day three things that I need to do. Like make it a point that those three things, no matter what I do, I actually write them. I don't put them onto a smartphone.
Okay.
Everybody has their own.
Thank you. Last question, last answer.
So something controversial. Don't please ask anything more controversial than anything.
Hi, my name is Albena. You mentioned very briefly, before joining Google, you said I knew my value as a young professional with the contract that expires in 15 days and a bit of a question mark in front of me. How did you know your value and how do you... Yeah, that's it. How do you know your value?
So what I was really bad at, for somebody who negotiated for a living, I was very bad at negotiating for myself. So if somebody gave me an offer, I very rarely tended to negotiate that. Right? One of the things I've now learned, and I really love this, is have a good sense of what you think you're worth and ask for that. The key is asking. Most of us don't ask. Right? I come out of a culture where growing up I was told, be quiet, be attentive, pay attention, and you know, listen to your ears. It's all very nice. But the reality is, you know, that held me back from being assertive for quite some time. And I'm actually fairly assertive, but I found that I couldn't ask for the same thing. Here's what you do. The really difficult part is asking, right? So, and you know, you're going to get pushback, right? People are going to say no to whatever you're asking. So some level of self-reflection is important. You need to understand what you're good at, what drives you, and then you go and ask that. It doesn't mean money all the time, it means many other things, right? The terms, the work, and all of that. My suggestion is go and ask that. And ask it, the important thing is tone at that point. Not just the ask, it's the way you ask that matters. For me, I find the two really work well. It's just not ask, it's the way you ask. And my strong suggestion is go and ask for it very directly, keeping eye contact. And this is where it makes I'm happy to talk to you about this. This is something I actually care about. I've spent a lot of time trying to figure out what's the right way of asking something.
Great. Amazing.
One more question. So they said you were going to ask something controversial.
So to rephrase, the question is about Debu's views on IB, intellectual property.
Okay, so there's a conflict. You understand what I'm saying?
Yep. Yeah. Yeah, sure. So I actually sit on Cambridge's board, and one of the things we do is we manage all of Cambridge's IP. And this is from a part of the university itself. So one of the interesting things is the American attitude towards IP is completely different to the European attitude towards IP. And I cannot tell you how different it is. In America, everything is immediately, any idea is generally, if you can afford it, you try and, you know, patent it, or at least you try and copyright it, depending on which way you're going. And over time, it's built a culture out there of developing everything based on IP and then protecting it. In the UK and in Europe, that culture doesn't exist in the classic sense. It's coming in now. And you can argue with two ways. The liberal way of saying is, IP shouldn't matter. It should all be shareable. Right? The reality is, especially in the life sciences, that's very tough. Because anything that you're doing, will take 10 years, between 10 to 15 years to see any money coming back. You have to protect yourself. In the software world, it's simpler, right? Because you know, you move fast, you break fast, and then whatever works, you then double down on it. But you need IP protection on certain industries as well. Where in America it's gone too far is the whole patent rule industry. Right? You've got a full industry out there whose only business is basically coming after you on IP, even if they have no real use for it. Now, that's a completely different way of doing IP that makes me very nervous. I've actually, and without going into the details, I probably worked on what's considered the biggest type of IP deal in the world. And it's really fascinating for me because for Google, we used to be very light on IP in the early days. And the reasoning was, you know, IP should be shareable. And then we suddenly found when we went into Android that people were coming after us or coming after us on a proxy basis. Right? They would come after our partners, which meant they were coming after us. And we had to figure out a way of protecting ourselves. And it required a completely different mindset. Right? Because it's not easy suddenly rewiring yourself to think in pure IP terms. And I don't think the way IP is thought of in Europe or the UK is the right model. There should be more of a premium. But you find a lot of investors out here don't get enough premium on IP. Whereas American investors will give you massive premiums on IP. And on the acquisition side, you generally get a much higher price if you have valuable IP. And you get a much higher price on the IP side in the States than you get here. I don't know if I'm answering your question quite the way you are asking.
We have not so much time, just a quick remark and then we just finish up.
You do get the attitude of, you know, you're a girl, she stays at home and, you know, have babies.
Again, I think being a software engineer, you're a very quantifiable profession. People look at your code and then they stop seeing you as a person. So if they look at the code and you go, wow, that's sweet, you know, that's really cool way of solving it, and suddenly you're the same as everyone else. So
I completely agree with that. Exactly, high performing teams, they look at the coding first, and then they forget about anything else. All the external parameters vanish.
Exactly.
Somebody else want to go.
I would like to provide the exact opposite experience. I'm not a software engineer, but I work in the energy sector, which is very, very, very male heavy. And I go to a lot of events, and 2 weeks ago I got called the B word in front of the Intercontinental Hotel. And I was told that a guy would ruin my career who was the CEO of an Italian company because I said no to being an escort to a nightclub. So it can be different in the energy sector.
Okay, now please join me without any further ado in thanking Debu Purkayastha.